JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for July the 31st. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar continued to slide against all but two of the other G10 currencies on Thursday and during the Asian morning Friday. It gained only against CAD, while it was found virtually unchanged against NOK. The main gainers were the pound, the euro and the New Zealand dollar in that order. The fact that the greenback stayed on the back foot suggests that markets may have traded in a risk-on manner yesterday. However, the fact that the oil-related Canadian dollar and NOK weakened as well points otherwise. Thus, once again, in order to get a better picture with regards to the broader market sentiment, we will turn our gaze to the equity world. Here, major EU indices were a sea of red, with the negative investor morale rolling into the US session as well. Although Nasdaq finished 0.43% up, both the Dow Jones Industrial Average and the S&P 500 slid 0.85% and 0.38% respectively. As for today and during the Asian morning Friday, Japan's Nikkei lost 2.81%, while at the time of recording, China's Shanghai Composite is virtually unchanged and Hong Kong's Hang Seng is down 0.40%. EU shares continued to tumble yesterday after the German GDP data showed that the Eurozone's economic powerhouse contracted by more than expected in the second quarter, with automakers taking a hit after Germany's Volkswagen revealed a first-half operating loss and after France's Renault posted a record net loss during the first half of this year. The fact that US President Trump raised the possibility of delaying November's presidential election may have also weighed on investors' appetite, which combined with the historic slump in the US GDP for the second quarter and the rising initial jobless claims for last week may have kept the Dow and the S&P down as well. It seems that the dollar is losing its safe haven appeal as it is now sold even during periods of risk aversion. Perhaps investors are getting rid of their greenbacks due to signs that the momentum of the US economic recovery is slowing down. With infected cases from the coronavirus staying in acceleration mode in the US, several states have stopped or even reversed their reopening, which according to data is dampening the economic recovery. With the US economy plunging during the second quarter, more recent data, like the initial jobless claims, suggest that the third quarter may also be marked by deep economic wounds. As far as the markets are concerned, following yesterday's slide in the equity world, we will turn sidelined again as we see the risk for the correction to continue for a while more. Even the technicals support that view, as several indices like DAX and Eurostoxx 50 broke below their recent short-term uptrend lines. Japan's Nikkei fell below the 22,000 key support zone and now looks to be headed towards the low of June 15th, near 21,365. Only the US indices are holding on to their recoveries, with the S&P 500 still holding above its psychological support zone of 3,200. What's more, the fact that Apple, Amazon, Facebook and Alphabet all reported better than expected earnings suggests that Wall Street may open with a positive gap today. Now, as for today, we have more second quarter GDP data due to be released, and that's from the Eurozone as a whole. We also get the block CPIs for July. GDP is expected to have shrunk 11.2% quarter over quarter, following a 3.6% contraction in the first quarter, while the headline CPI is expected to have ticked down to 0.2% year over year from 0.3%. No forecast is currently available for the core rate, which stood at 0.8% year over year in June. That said, with the German CPI sliding into negative waters, we would consider the risks surrounding the Eurozone print as tilted slightly to the downside. Now, at its latest meeting, the ECB did not alter its monetary policy, but stayed ready to adjust all its instruments as appropriate to ensure that inflation moves towards its aim in a sustained manner. At the press conference following the decision, President Lagarde urged EU governments to take action in battling the coronavirus pandemic as soon as possible, with EU leaders eventually reaching consensus last Tuesday morning. The euro has been on a rally mode recently, on hopes that with a fiscal aid, the eurozone is now likely to recover faster, and the return of the July PMIs into expansionary territory increased those hopes. Thus, it may need much worse than expected GDP and CPI numbers to revive fears with regards to a halt in the economic recovery and thereby speculation for more stimulus by the ECB. If the actual prints come close to their forecasts, despite weaker than the previous ones, we believe that the euro could continue to gain, especially against the dollar, which continues to tumble even as the overall market is trading in a risk of fashion. Excuse me. Now, as for the rest of today's events, from the US we have personal income and spending alongside the core PCE index, all for June. Personal income is forecast to have declined 0.5% month over month after falling 4.2% in May, while personal spending is expected to have slowed to plus 5.5% month over month from plus 8.2%. With regards to the core PCE index, it is forecast to have held steady at 1% year over year. We also have the final University of Michigan Consumer Sentiment Index for July, which is expected to be revised down to 72.9 from 73.2. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. Now, at this point, I have to let you know that there will be no weekly Market Outlook webinar on Monday, neither a daily market review video for next week. So goodbye, have a great day, a greater weekend, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again on the week starting August the 10th.
JFT, just fair and direct.